let me begin by asking you, what were the objectives of your class today?
Okay, so it's been about 3 weeks now since we started the science education course, which is a pedagogy course within the program. And we were looking at different perspectives on cognition and how children make sense of science concepts. So in that context, we were talking of situative perspectives on cognition. What does it mean when you say the context is important, that the child and the environment cannot be separated? And therefore, can we look at an example of how this unfolds, right? How activity unfolds and how children make sense of science through a meaningful activity, right? So in that context, I wanted to bring up a study that I had done recently, and it was based on this perspective. And recently we had written up a research paper on that. So it was like a case study. It was using that as in the research study as an exemplar to bring out situative perspectives on cognition. So I was basically describing the research questions which motivated the study, the context, what kinds of meaning making happened through the activities that we had planned in the context of science, and what were the learnings from there, both for in terms of cognition as well as informal learning settings. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So that those were my broad objectives.
Were you able to meet those objectives today?
Yes, I think fairly. I would have liked to get into more details perhaps, but given 1.5 hours what we were able to do, I think I was fairly satisfied that I was able to describe most aspects of what was done in the research study, and also the paper was shared with students prior to the class, so there the details were present. So the details that I couldn't get into, hopefully they would be also able to read and discuss in the classes to come.
So clearly you see that there is value of bringing one's own research or empirical work into classroom discussions when you are in a science education class, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah, certainly, because one, it's also something that is close to the teacher's heart, in the sense your own research, and using that in the classroom is something that's meaningful. It's a way of seeing teaching and research as not something that are very separate from each other, but integrated, can be brought meaningfully into the classroom in whatever way is possible.
So I observed in your class that it was largely discussion based, right? Student participation,
yes,
was quite intense, and students responded to the questions that you asked and made observations to your work that you shared.
Yes.
How important is this student interaction, and do you think there is an underlying message that you want to give related to teaching of science itself by using such forms of pedagogy in the classroom?
Yes, I think, yeah, discussion is definitely important, a dialogue is important. It sort of alerts the teacher also to whether you are making sense in the classroom, whether there are ideas that are interesting, and what kind of, what are the connections that the students are making to what we have learned so far in the course. So discussion helps to bring out these aspects, and of course, the obvious thing of clarification, doubts, further questions that emerge, unhappiness, so all of this can come through very well through discussion, so definitely it's important. It helps if there is a context to the discussion, and therefore sharing a reading beforehand, sharing readings beforehand helps, because then the discussion is not in a vacuum, and students have a context with which to discuss, and when the teacher is presenting it in class, looking at it in the context of what you've already read, it certainly helps.
So yeah, that's exactly the question that I wanted to ask next. How much, how do you value this prior preparation and prior reading in your classes? Do you think it's really, really valuable? And what happens when some students in the class do not come prepared for reading, I mean, with the reading that you have assigned?
Yeah. So one is, I notice if it's a completely new idea, new concept being introduced, it may be fair to allow students to first be introduced to it in class and then go back and read. In some cases where, like in an empirical study such as this, it may be easier to just go through it and then, you know, clarify the terms, difficult concepts, extra in class. But having said that, yeah, I do assign readings every week, there are multiple things happening, so of course a student should be able to find the time. Sometimes there are valid reasons, sometimes there aren't, but at least I think as a teacher, the consciousness that yeah, there is a context in which all of this is presented, that there are readings, and which means I also have to be prepared with this and more. yeah, so I think that is important, bringing that up. Whether it happens or not is a factor of so many other things that are happening, so many variables which some can be controlled, some can't be.
Sindhu, how did you plan for this class? What goes into planning for a class?
So this is in continuation of the unit on learning science, and we've so of course it goes in a continuous mode that we started with children's conceptions, different perspectives, and so it involves engaging with reading, definitely the required readings that are assigned for students, and beyond that to see if there is clarity in my own ideas, right, in my own thoughts about it, if I am clear about what is represented in the paper, by looking at other sources as well related to the same topic, maybe secondary sources. Mm-hmm. So, for example, if I'm reading Love on cognition, on situated cognition, some of the language can get complex. Mm-hmm. And if I have to present it in class to students, I will also have to read up others who have written about the same topic to make sure that it's clear to me. Or if I disagree, then that's a different thing. But at least it should be clear that I have understood what the author is trying to present. That is one. Of course, I have to consider where we are in the course, and if it builds on concepts that they're already familiar with, or if it's a completely new concept that is being introduced or idea that is being introduced, in which case I have to go a little slow. I also notice that as a teacher, I tend to go fast, that I speak fast and I tend to rush. So I have to also consciously tell myself to use simple things like, for instance, I realize if I'm using the blackboard, then I have to necessarily go slow. Whereas if I keep using the PPT, then I may go a little faster. But the PPT has certain advantages. The blackboard has certain advantages. So that then engaging them with an informal exploratory activity also helps to go slow, brings out their ideas about that topic. And then I can go from there. So there are different aspects involved.
What are some assumptions that you have about your students' prior learning for a class of science education?
Considering we don't really expect a particular kind of science background, and science is a very diverse and large discipline, so you have those who would be, comfortable with any of those sub branches, right? So either physics, chemistry or biology. I have a background in biology. So I may typically take examples related to biology in class because I am comfortable with it. At the same time, I have to be aware that students may come from different backgrounds even within science. So considering that, I may bring up, I may consciously try to look for examples in physics and chemistry as well sometimes. On the other hand, I may also ask students if they can connect to, similar examples in physics and chemistry when we're talking, for example, the nature of science. Then there could be some common aspects which can apply across disciplines. So the assumptions would definitely be linked to what we have done in the course, what has been clearly set as foundations, right? I mean, so that can be assumptions, but other than that, in terms of science content, not too many assumptions, because of this whole diversity that we have. But I notice in discussion, always we're able to find some examples that can connect.
But in your view, what is the importance of this content in science education? Isn't that important?
That's very important as a teacher. But considering that this course is also to do with perspectives, pedagogy, one can look at smaller meaningful units, right? Examples rather than so it's not a science content course. Mm-hmm. Where clearly we'll go in a sequential manner, organized according to more foundational basic concepts to more complex concepts. Here it is so units are related to philosophy of science and society, right? Teaching science, learning science, so it brings in different perspectives, and it's possible to use appropriate examples, content examples when required.
Would you like to tell me a little bit about the forms of assessment that you use in this particular course?
So as far as possible, considering this is an elective, we have primarily written submissions and an oral presentation. The submissions, so the first assignment is related to a study of children's conceptions in a particular significant concept in science. Then there is an assignment related to understanding science and society issues through doing an interview with a scientist from a disadvantaged background or a woman scientist, and writing a biography on the scientist and also presenting it in class. Then last year I felt it worked quite well. This year let's see how it works. Yeah. Then there's also a short reading to be done based on a theme from the philosophy of science, based on which they write a response paper. And last year, I remember some students picked up science fiction also and looked at a theme related to philosophy of science in there and presented and wrote up a response paper. Then there is, of course, their practicum teaching, which is a very core central part of what they do in the pedagogy course. So writing up, writing up a detailed teaching plan, executing, implementing it in the classroom, in the practicum school, and writing up their observations and reflections on their own class. That's an important part. And then of course there is class participation, which is valued, the discussions that happen in class, engagement with activities, all of that.
And
yeah.
What is the plan for the rest of the classes, the future plan for classes? What is the content mostly that you will be covering? You already mentioned some of this.
Yeah. So they will have to teach the students as part of their practicum and as an assessed component, for which they will have to consider what we have done so far related to children's conceptions and use that in planning their own teaching of a particular topic. And the first assignment that they will do is also linked to children's conceptions in a particular topic. So I will have to take that further into looking at developing a meaningful teaching plan in science without getting stuck in a particular format. And getting them to write their own teaching plans and implement it in school. So that will be the next few classes to wrap up that unit on learning science and moving on to teaching science a little more deeply after that.
So thank you very much. Really enjoyed having this conversation with you, and it was a fantastic learning experience for me as well.
It was nice for me.
Thank you very
well.
Much. Yeah.
Good morning, all of you. Before we start today's class, we'll just go through some of the aspects we've seen. It's about 3 weeks now since we've started science education, right? So we started with the unit on learning science. Right? And we first looked at constructivism. Right, different shades of constructivism, and the idea that constructivism as a movement was a very important milestone in education and particularly for science education. What was constructivism primarily about? Can anyone say?
So it was somewhat in opposition to Locke's idea of child as a blank slate and as a passive recipient of knowledge. So constructivism says that child is an active learner and is a participant in his or her own learning process. It constructs knowledge in the classroom. So.
Yes. Yeah. Anybody else would like to add anything further to this?
Ma'am, it is what... Okay, another layer to it is that it is what a child makes meaning of. I mean, the child itself constructs the meanings of the outside reality.
Okay.
And it is also experiential in nature.
Okay. So so we looked at different shades of constructivism, and we saw that there could be also extreme views, right? This idea that all of knowledge is constructed, and the idea that everything is given, right, in nature for the child to discover. So you can also take very extreme positions as far as constructivism is concerned. But we also saw that an important outcome of this constructivist approach was this whole body of research examining children's conceptions. Right? So we saw how children's conceptions, right, in the context of science about the natural world, help us understand what it is that they bring into the classroom and helps the teacher address this in the teaching learning process. Right? So that was an important outcome. Right? And we saw certain characteristics of children's conceptions. Right? What are these characteristics? Anyone can recall? What are children's conceptions? When we say children's conceptions, what does it mean? Yeah.
Children's conceptions are that they have certain hypothesis or a theory which could have been passed on through age, there is this cultural thing.
Okay, so children have various theories about the world, they have various experiences, right, that they bring into the classroom with links, right, which, and these conceptions have links with science, right? So before formal science is taught in the classroom, these conceptions may interfere with the formal understanding of science and scientific concepts, right? And we also saw that these conceptions are very personal, right? That that it's something that children construct by themselves individually. At the same time, that there are similarities across cultural contexts, right? There are certain conceptions that are similar across cultural contexts, right? So that's also interesting. While it is personal, there are also large similarities, right? And then we also saw that it is stable in the sense that it is very resistant to change, right? That they are they hold on to them even into adulthood, right? That they refuse to part with them even after formal instruction, right? They can be contradictory, right? Children's conceptions can be looked at as a framework, alternative framework, which can have contradictions and inconsistencies, and they are happy to live with that, right? So the teacher considering this and addressing this in the classroom is very important, right? Then from there, we saw yesterday we were looking at other perspectives, right, which are also linked to constructivism in a certain sense, but differ from what we have earlier seen, right, the earlier approaches that we have looked at, right, which is looking at the child's relationship with the environment, right. Now, the body of research that we have looked at in the context of children's conceptions, imagine that the child and the environment are two separate entities, right? I'm not saying that all of the research imagines this, but a large body of research does consider that the child exists and the environment exists and they interact, right? And then we also saw perspectives which assume that you can't separate the child and the environment, just like you can't separate nature and nurture, right? They both go hand in hand. They are mutually inseparable, right? Yeah. Right. Which means that it's not just a matter of interaction, right? It is meaning making, which is fused in a certain sense, right? It is something that emerges organically, right? And therefore, we need to study children's meaning making, not through separate instances or simple questions that are posed to the child, right, or simple tasks that are given, right? We study through this perspective using activities, right? Now, I put it within quotes because we discussed yesterday that activity here is not just a simple, simple thing that is done, a simple task that is done. An activity is a complex unit, right? So what is, do you recall what we had discussed regarding activity yesterday? Yeah, Pooja.
So the activity, it's a goal-oriented group work, or if I am giving an activity to children, I have certain goal in my mind, and we will all work towards that goal together.
Yes. So there's a goal, right? The unit is a cultural unit as well, right? It's not just a separate, isolated unit. It is also looked at as a cultural unit where children work together, take on tasks, right? Exercise agency, right? If you remember, we used that word yesterday. What does agency mean?
Agency is the child himself or herself, the one who is doing the activity, who is engaged in the activity.
So the child takes initiative, right? The child is able to take initiative, ask for help when required, involve peers, involve elders, right? And do the task like a member of a community or a group or a social group, right? So Yeah, so activity theory says that an activity is an important unit of analysis to understand meaning making. It assumes that the child and the environment, or the child and the social context, are inseparable. It's a meaningful unit to study how children understand science or any topic for that matter. And therefore, we take this to be the unit of analysis. Yeah, Meera.
I'm not getting what is the difference between the activity and the pedagogy. Because if...
So we look at one example. So maybe you can, it'll get clarified there, because we're going to be discussing this today, right? Okay. So activity is not just a simple task, but as something more complex. So we'll look at an example today, right? So moving on, we also saw the idea of cognition as apprenticeship, right, which is linked to this, right, and called situated cognition or situative perspectives. Right? So the idea there is the child is an apprentice, meaning is working with a facilitator or a teacher, or it could be even a peer who knows more than the child, right? Mean be an expert in that sense, who knows everything, right? But a peer or an elder who knows more than the child within the community and learns, right? Learns a particular skill, learns some knowledge, learns a concept from that peer or elder, right? Through the process of engaging in a shared activity, right? So so this approach was, and we looked at Love, who spoke about this approach, and this is also an important perspective to consider here when we're looking at children's meaning making, right? Okay, so today we are going to be looking at an example from a study that I and some of my colleagues had done last year. I had sent around the paper as well that we just came out with. I don't know if any of you managed to read it, right? But basically, this will give you a summary of what we had done and what kind of analysis was carried out, right? So this I'm going to be illustrating as an example of using a situative perspective, right? But also going beyond that to look at what we saw yesterday as science identity, right? So identity, what does it mean? What does identity refer to?
Sense of self.
So a child's sense of self, right? So the sense of self could be a certain interest, what the child thinks of himself or herself. But it's not only an individual perspective, it's also a relational perspective, right? How does a child see himself or herself in relation to a social group that the child is part of, a peer group, right? Or a religious group, right? It could involve a relational perspective also, child as in relation to others. Now, science identity would refer to the particular case of science, right? What is the relationship between a child and science, right? And we saw that Love was referring to a child in an apprenticeship kind of model as a peripheral participant. Why peripheral? Because the child's identity is perhaps not fully there, right, involved or brought out, right, or made explicit. It is typically the skill that is emphasized, right? So in a tailoring example that we saw yesterday, it is a skill of tailoring that is emphasized, but usually we don't bring out the idea of the identity of the child and how does that engage with the activity, right? So in this example, we'll also see how the science identity of the child, right? A sense of self in relation to science is elicited and brought out, and how activity in the context that we have seen enables that to happen, right? Enables a child's identity to be brought out, right? In many ways, yeah, really.
I'm just wondering, why are we calling this situative perspectives or situated cognition?
Yeah, so looking at situation, right, situated as contextual, right, the context being very important, and the context here is a meaningful activity, right, a meaningful activity that the child is engaged with. So this is opposed to a perspective which says, let's look at a simple activity which is devoid of context, because that will help us study a psychological trait better, right? So typically this is done in cognitive psychology also. You're removing all the extraneous variables, or even in a science experiment, right? You're removing out the unnecessary variables in order to study your object of interest, right? Now here it is messy because you have this complex context, which is a cultural unit, right? Which means you'll have different elements coming in there, and it's situated in that sense. But it is messy, right? So that's something one has to bear with, but it's meaningful also because of that. Yeah, is it clear now? Yeah, okay. So we'll move on to this example. So the title of the paper is Exploring Hybrid Spaces Through an Informal Science Learning Program, right? So there are two, three words here that we've not quite discussed, yeah? Any idea what this could refer to? What is hybrid?
Spaces that children create while learning science, so, yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. In informal settings, while they are engaged into activities, these are spaces that they create themselves. Mm-hmm.
Okay, yeah. Any other perspective? Yeah? Yeah.
I thought something it is inorganic.
Something is?
Inorganic.
Inorganic, okay. Yeah.
Ma'am, for example, they want to know about living and non-living things. They will engage with the environment, with the plants, to know whether it is living or non-living.
Okay. Let's see what the paper is about. Yeah, we'll get to that and then we can discuss the questions.
About hybrid, I feel that the breeds which are available in the environment, we try to produce a more better breed from there, from that thing.
Okay, so let's see. Yeah, these are your conceptions about the study, right? So when we get to it, let's see what happens. Yeah. So exploring hybrid spaces through an informal science learning program, right? So clearly the idea was an informal space, which means not a typical school environment or a classroom that is structured, a typical classroom, a conventional classroom that is structured within a school environment. This took place in the Learning Resource Center over here next door, right? And we had children coming in from a nearby practicum school, right? And they were engaged with different activities on campus over a period of a month, right? And they chose these activities based on their interests. So we'll see what actually happened and what was this hybrid space that they created. Hybrid, as the word connotes, is a combination, a mixture, right? A compound, if you wish, right? Something new emerging, right? Or it could be just two things put together, right? There are different connotations associated with the word hybrid, and we'll see what is meant by that, right? Okay, so these were the questions that we took up for our exploration. We were a group of four people who did this particular study, right? How do children create new spaces for deeper engagement with science? And what do these spaces look like, right? Now, So if children are given the space, right, the mental space, to be able to explore and choose a topic that is of interest to them, right, how do they do that, and how would they go about that exploration with some guidance and scaffolding with facilitators around, right? So that was one question. How do informal settings support the development of hybrid spaces, right? So I'll come to the definition of hybrid spaces and what it means. But basically the idea that how do they bring in, right, this science identity into the activities that they do? How do they bring in aspects of their socio-cultural worlds, right, and their other experiences related to science into the learning of science, right? So that's something that we wanted to look at. And how is that facilitated by informal settings, right? Is there some special space that informal settings hold, right, that allows for that more naturally and organically? What are the different funds of knowledge that children bring from their home and informal learning experiences into science learning, right? So funds of knowledge is a familiar word to you? No? Okay. So there are different kinds of knowledges that children bring with them, right? It could have links with science, it may not have links with science. It may be linked to something that they have read about, seen on TV, experienced in the environment, talked about with friends, experienced in the science classroom, in school, right? So there are different kinds of knowledges that children bring into the classroom. And this supports or hinders their science learning, but it is just interesting for us to characterize them, right? To understand what are these different kinds of knowledges and how does it merge with what is being presented in a science learning environment, an informal science learning environment, right? So we look at the details later and you can ask me then if you have any questions, right? So we're going to explore some of these questions through a short empirical study which looked at informal learning spaces in science learning. And the study, as I just said, comprised of a short summer camp. About 20 children had come in and they were divided further into smaller groups based on their interests, right? So in the course of a month, there were some 12 sessions in all, right? Which means that we didn't have sessions every day. We had it spread, right, over the course of a month. And each session lasted for about 3 hours. Children divided themselves into groups based on their interests, right? We were 4 facilitators handling different groups of children based on their research interests, right? And this presentation, I'm going to be talking about the engagement of a group of 5 girls who had picked the topic of plants, trees, and insects, right? So they had chosen this. They said that we want to do something, with trees, with plants in the environment. We want to move around, right, the campus. We want to see, we're new here. So we said, okay, I mean, let's make this combination of plants, trees, and insects. Maybe that describes the group best. And the children all came from a nearby school, which is also a practicum school, and they're primarily from low socioeconomic backgrounds, right? So the children, as part of the study, explored the campus. They made observations about trees and insects on campus, trees, plants, and insects on campus. They also collected leaves, flowers, fruits, right? They said they wanted to collect and do something with it, so they did that. Some of them wanted to collect dead insects. Some of them wanted to catch live insects. So they did all of that, right? Then they brought some seeds from home, and they did a bit of gardening. They grew these seeds in little containers and watched them germinate, watched them grow, made observations about them. We'll look at the details a little later. This is just to give you an overall view, right? Then, based on what kinds of plants they were growing, they also interviewed members of their immediate and wider community, right? So they interviewed their parents, grandparents, interviewed members of faculty and staff about the plants that they were growing, because they were mostly food plants, right? Grains that are commonly available, right? So we'll see that also in a bit, right? Then they also decided towards the last week or so of the camp to come up with a little magazine, right? One documenting all the work that they had done, and partly also to bring in their other interests, right? So they said their interest in artwork, they engage with paintings, and they brought this, right? And they said that we would like to, bring this into a little magazine, right? Use it in some way. So they did that as well, and most of this structure was decided by them, right? So they sort of indicated what is it that they wish to do, right? And they were middle schoolers. They had some idea, right, of these things. They've done some of these activities in school, but they haven't explored it sufficiently. So they this structure was largely decided by them. Yeah. So the children were engaging very intensely with all of this, right? Because they were very interested. They chose this group. They decided that this is what they wanted to do. So there was a very intense engagement. It was very difficult to keep pace with it. Yeah. And also during this whole project, I was like a participant observer. I was traveling with them in the bus from the school here and also taking them back. So I was interacting with them in ways outside the classroom as well, right? So I got to sort of understand many of them better, right? And what their worlds outside the science classroom meant, what science itself meant to them, right? What is it, what is school science with all of its abstraction and concepts, what does it mean to them, right? And I noticed certain patterns in the way they engaged, right, with all of their work and what they were speaking about, right? So to understand, first of all, how children were making sense of the topics that they had picked up,
I was using a broadly interpretivist framework, right? If you remember from research methods, yeah? What is interpretivism? So you're looking at, you're trying to look at what happens, right? Either as phenomena or observations through the eyes of your participants, right? By questioning them, by asking them about their views, right, etc. So it's primarily, leads to qualitative kinds of methods, yeah? So I was using 2-3 lenses here to understand how they were making meaning, right? One is looking at science learning in informal settings, right? What is a value that an informal space brings in, right? So an informal space can be conceptualized in many ways, right? You can look at a science informal space as even an after-school science program, right? A club that children are running in school. You can look at it as a summer camp that is held, right? What other examples? Any other examples? Yeah.
At home, in the kitchen?
Doing some work in the family that is culturally meaningful with links to science. Yeah, could be, right? It could be a science center. It could be a visit to a planetarium. It could be a visit to a museum, right? A zoo, right? So different kinds of experiences which have some links to science, which lead to some science learning, because we're looking at it as a science, informal science setting, right? So I looked at that literature which is linked to that, right? Then I was looking at identity construction. What is this notion of science identity? How does it get constructed, right? Is it a fixed entity? Does it keep developing over a period of time, right? And we look at some answers to these questions as we go along. But this was a question of interest to me. And I was also looking at associated literature linked to that, right? And hybridity theory. Now, hybridity theory is basically talking about this third space that children develop, merging their social worlds with the formal environment in the classroom, right? So children seem to create this third space which merges, right, the formal space that they encounter in by way of school science, right, expectations from a typical science classroom, right, and its expectation of obedience, of structure, of conforming, right, a textbook-centered understanding of concepts, right, whatever it may be, or even a progressive sense of making observations, of engaging with activities in the classroom, right. With their social and cultural experiences, right? As members of a social group, as members of a cultural group, right? As members of a particular region or locality, right? And we look at examples for all of these later. But this basically conceptualizes the new spaces that children form to merge, right? And you can see the links here between how children bring in, you know, various conceptions from their everyday worlds and merge it, right, with what is presented to them as structures in a formal setting, right? And then, I'm not going to go through all of these points, but basically the idea that we also discussed yesterday, that the middle school years are very critical for science. Why? Because, why? Yeah, Krishna.
Because we will give in the middle class most of the fundamental in science.
Okay, so one, it's the period when you enter into the disciplinary understanding of science, right? Before that, you have environmental studies, which is thematic, which engages with science and social science, and then you move into a disciplinary understanding. One is that. Any other reason? Yeah, so adolescent period, right? A period when your sense of identity, sense of self is very strong. And by then, you also have a sense of what are the expectations from me as a science student. And therefore, how do I see myself in relation to science, right? Is this for me? Is this something that I enjoy doing? This is not for me, it's for nerds, right? Or this is for me because, I'm bright, right? So these kinds of ideas, right, develop at the middle school, and therefore it's interesting to see, right? So some things that I've written here broadly to summarize are that one child may think that that I'm not suited to engage with science because the expectation is one of discipline, order, being academic, right? Another child may not see the relevance of engaging with science since the harshness of living under difficult circumstances, right? may render such experiences meaningless, right? That there's something else on the top of your mind. It's not science, right? It is about surviving, right? It is about making do with what you have, about living under very difficult circumstances, right? And there's a lot of research which I've drawn from on homeless children in the US, right? Researchers working with homeless children in the US who clearly state, I mean, we don't see the relevance of all of the science content because our lives are so difficult, right? We would like to understand more about nutrition because that's something that's meaningful to us, right? It's where we get very little of food, or we'd like to understand about pollution better because we live in an industrial area with so much pollution around, right? So these are some of the perspectives that come through. And also the fact that role models in the community, so you see your cousin or your sister, somebody whom you know as having taken up a career in science, and therefore you find that this is meaningful, right, for you to take up later on, right? On the other hand, even if you find it meaningful and you see that there are no role models in your community, you may wonder, I mean, is this something that people do even? I mean, later on, do they really take up careers in science? Is there something like that? Is it something meaningful for me, right? So these are the kinds of questions linked to a science identity, right?
Ma'am, when you gave the example of pollution and the environment around, so are we just restricting science definition to a little one? Because pollution itself comes into a science, right?
Yes.
Like, or the nutrition itself is a part of
science.
That's
right. So industries. That's right. So thinking about it, not only so looking at a critical perspective of science and society, right? So is science a contributor in that sense to pollution, right? And in a certain sense also alleviates, right? So what is it? I mean, looking at a critical perspective here, right? Rather than looking at it as a given. Right, we discussed this earlier, typically content which is given to you as opposed to something that you can critically look at, right? And so that's an important perspective here, right? A critical perspective rather than reifying science as an important. Yeah, okay, so moving on. Yeah, so what are hybrid spaces? Now in this particular study, I use the framework given by Barton, Angela Calabrese Barton, who did a lot of work in the US with homeless children, with African American girls, right, to see what are the spaces that they create in, even in the formal science classroom, right? What are these new spaces that they develop in order to merge their social identities, right, what they bring into the science classroom with what is presented in the science classroom as formal structures or the curriculum, right? And there are three broad ways in which I've tried to categorize, right, or try to understand hybrid spaces in this particular study, right? What is meant by this? So a convergent space, as we saw, is just a coming together, a converging, right, of what is academically privileged in the science classroom and what could be traditionally marginalized, right, in the community. And we will look at examples, so you could let me know. As of now, I'm just kind of characterizing three broad examples, right? It can also be looked at as a navigational space or a way of crossing and succeeding in different discourse communities, right? What does this mean? It's a loaded statement, right? So what is it, what is a kind of space that is developed by children as a way of succeeding in science, right? As a way of navigating through the formal science that is presented in the classroom. And thirdly, as a transformative space, a space of cultural, social, and epistemological change where competing knowledges and discourses challenge and reshape, right? Which means that the very idea of what is science itself, right, of science knowledge itself, is reshaped, right? Is reshaped meaning there is a different understanding emerging of what is science in the science classroom. Right? In the science classroom, can we look at a more flexible understanding of science, right? Or can we bring in the worlds that children inhabit into the science classroom to make it more meaningful for them? And in that process, bring about a transformation of our understanding of what we believe is science. Yeah? So we look at some examples for all of these in the next. Yeah.
This reshaping happens in the elementary classes, maybe?
So it's a continuous process, right? It begins, so just as we look at a child from infancy, right, as actively engaging with the world, it is a continuous process of construction and reconstruction, right? So a primary child may have a very positive kind of relationship with science. But when it gets to the middle school, when it gets to certain social norms that come in, right? When it comes through science, when it comes to the stage where science as a discipline is being introduced, that identity may change, right? It may get reconstructed as something else, right? And by the time the child is in high school, again, it may be a different kind of identity that emerges, right? So looking at this as not a fixed concept or a construct, but something that changes and develops over a period of time, yeah? So the conceptual framework, I don't know if it is very clear. Is it clear from the back? Yeah, it's not very clear. Okay, so I'll just broadly tell you what. So looking at hybrid spaces, primarily studying it, right? And it could be characterized in the three ways that we just saw, right? And they basically, hybrid spaces merge the sociocultural worlds of the students with the normative expectations of school science, right? What is normative? Yeah, there are certain norms that are given in the science classroom, which we saw, the expectation from a science student, right? And then, hybrid spaces lead to negotiation, development, and reconstruction of science identities, right? So it's a continuous process. And it can be studied using situative perspectives on cognition. And also looking at informal settings as a very important setting to facilitate, which facilitates the construction of hybrid spaces. And examples of informal settings are after school programs, museums, zoos, etc. Right? So this is broadly a kind of depiction, right? So the structure of learning experiences, yeah.
If there is a formal space and if there is an informal space, is it required somebody should be there to facilitate, or it is not a requirement?
So you can look at a completely, so look at constructivism, right? The way we looked at the two poles. You can look at a space which is completely unstructured also as an informal space, right? And very often children do experience this in the families, right? They could be left by themselves completely without any facilitation. So you can imagine a space like that. Now, in the context of education, we typically imagine a space which is facilitated, right? Because education being an intentional endeavor, having certain aims and objectives, right? The idea is not to structure it as much as a science classroom, but at least to facilitate in the Vygotskian sense, right? That one looks at where the child is at this point, where the child would like to go, right? Is capable of going, right? And therefore, that scaffolding at least has to be there. But again, the whole range, right? The whole range from a very extreme unstructured to looking at structured, but that won't be an informal space then if it's fully structured, yeah? So these are the various things that they did. They articulated their interests first, right? Then they came up with their group, right? So the other groups that were formed were, so one group wanted to work on chemistry, right? Chemical reactions. Another group wanted to work on space, right? Space research. Another group wanted to work on the human body system, and they took up circulatory system. So this was a group that I'm focusing on, working on plants, trees, and insects broadly. And then they observed different trees and plants, and they had a worksheet, right? Based on which they observed developmental stages, right? So for example, they would look at the leaves, right? And they would tick whether it was fresh or mature, right? Then they would look at the fruits, if they were there on the tree, right? Ripe, unripe, the flowering stage, right? And any insects or animals on the trees or plants engaging with some kind of behavior, right? Then after that, they tabulated their observations, right? To understand first the diversity on campus in terms of trees, plants, and insects, right? Trying to classify them using formal systems of classification, right? Trying to plot, use certain scientific conventions such as graphical representations and tabulations, right? To just sort of systematically put down what they had observed, right? Observed not just in terms of what are the trees and plants and animals, but also to see the developmental stages, to see different kinds of behaviors exhibited by insects on campus. If they noted down other animals in that as well, but it was primarily insects because that was their interest. Then they made scrapbooks, right? So they said they would like to make scrapbooks using their various collections, as well as documenting all the things that they had done. So they had made graphical representations, so documenting that, right? and also sticking the various specimens and samples that they had collected. Then after that, they decided to switch to do observe growing seeds, right? So brought seeds from home, grew it in little containers, kept in the lab, right, with compost, watched the different stages of germination, observed them every day, right, noted down their observations on worksheets, right? Then they interviewed family and community members on these seeds, so ragi, for example, right? Looking at its cultural uses, right, value, right, of consuming that as an important part of the diet, right, changes in the diet over the years, right? So they had these questions that were written up and they asked, right, they interviewed. So this was, yeah, this is also a plant that they were growing, and this is also a traditional dish. So for us, it was quite new. All the facilitators were not localites in that sense. So, yeah, and so it was quite interesting to see. So observations and analysis. So I'll be looking at certain, I'll be drawing from my field notes as well as the observations I made during the camp, right? And I'll be presenting them here. So the first characterization of hybrid spaces that we saw, right, as a convergence space between academic and traditionally marginalized knowledges and discourses, right? So what is meant by this? So bringing in what you have understood, right, as traditional knowledge into an academic space, right? So for example, while I'm going to read out, and this is from my field notes, while making observations and identifying trees and plants on campus, many of them recalled names and attributes of local trees, right, which they had learned from their informal experiences, such as honge, right, familiar tree. Yeah, okay, so you can see it, it's there on our campus, right? It's also a very popular local tree, right? Pongamia pinnata, it's also called Indian beech tree, right? And gasagase, that's, so I learned this all from the children, right? This is Singapore cherry, it's called. I mean, we had to look up the common name in more common ways, right? And this is the Muntungia calabura is the scientific name, right? So these are experiences that they've had while playing in the neighborhood, right? And they live in an area close to the school, which is full of trees, relatively quieter compared to the city, right? You don't have the peak hour traffic and all of that interfering with your life, so you can continue to play, right, when you have holidays in the morning and there are spaces available. So they had all of these observations about, for example, fruits, right? Fruits of the gasagase tree. When is it ready to be eaten, right? What are the visual characteristics of it? The particular smell, right? The color and the appearance, which allow it to be eaten, right? And when is it not ready to be eaten, right? Now, this is not an uncommon finding. If you sort of, I don't know how many of you grew up in environments of that kind, but it's not very difficult to find children describing, plants and animals in their immediate environment, like they know them really well, right? The taste of the cherry or the fruit, right, how it looks like in different seasons, right? So they brought in all of this knowledge from their informal experiences into the science class when we were discussing classification of these trees, right? And another, some other interesting events, which I don't know if I'll be able to describe fully, were also brought in to the science classroom, not always with links to science, right? So for example, one day they found this dead python near the school, right, on a drain. Somebody had, of course, killed it, right, mistaken it to be, or this is a typical occurrence, right, as soon as you see a snake, kill it, right, as a group, mob attack, right? So they had observed this. It's not clear from this picture, but there's a dead python here, it's a drain, and there's a bottle over here, right, used to kill it. So one day in the morning while we were waiting for the bus to come, the children saw this python and they immediately started associating, okay, is this a snake? I mean, what is a reptile? Or, what about, is this anaconda, right? We've seen the movie, so let's make connections. So they were doing this very organically, informally, in their own groups, right? And there was a lot of talk and conversation that happened regardless of what the teacher was doing or whether we had to go, right? It was part of their local practice, right? Two other interesting events that happened around the same time. This was in April last year, right? The Hosa Road Fair. I don't know if any of you have seen this. Kosar Road Fair? Anyone? No. I mean, yeah, I don't know. You all may not have been. Yeah, perhaps you would have been here last year in April. But anyway, yeah. So this is actually a fair that's very unique to Hosar Road, right? You have fairs, of course, in different parts of the country and in Karnataka as well, in different areas. But this is something that you see in Hosar Road. There is this goddess who is, you know, put up on this, you know, tall elevated structure, right? And there's a lot of decoration and music and the games for kids and all of this. So since they were part of that local community, they were actually inviting me to come for their fair and be part of the celebration. So this was something that was very new to me, something that I'd never heard about. But then I remembered after they told me that I'd actually seen this happening, right? But I didn't know what it was. So for example, you typically see people in the fair carrying bananas and throwing it at this goddess, right? Who's called Annamal, right? It's supposed to touch her head, right? And then your wish is granted. So that is that's something I observed everyone throwing bananas then, and I was wondering what is happening. That looked very funny, but then I realized, oh gosh, I mean, this is a very important cultural event for them, and they were actually inviting me to it, right? So again, not with clear links to science, but the fact that they found space, right, in an informal space to bring in all of their local experiences into the classroom, right? The garment workers' protests, again, not part of the science classroom, but this was again interesting to see that, you know, a local protest that came about, right? You may have heard about it in the news, right? So some of the children's parents were part of that protest, and they brought that into the whole discourse when we were talking about plants and trees around, and then there was this charged environment of the protests there as well, right? So looking at all of this as a convergent kind of space, right? The second aspect, second characterization we will look at is as a navigational space, right? The hybrid space as a navigational space, which means how do I navigate now with this different language that is presented in the science classroom, right? No, a formal language that is presented there, and my own social world, which is quite different, right, from the science classroom. So for instance, they saw it as a space which was a kind of change for them from their regular science classroom, in allowing them freedom to move, right? So they saw that as something that's something that they liked as children, but something that a science class didn't quite provide, right? The space to move around, the space to walk around, observe things, write, right? Follow insects. So they would describe their following of insects, saying that, you know, it's like following little children through maze-like paths. It's very difficult to catch these children, right? It's they're always naughty, running here and there behind trees. You can't sit down and make observations of them, right? They always escape, right? So things like that. So they saw this whole process of collecting, describing, watching insects as a fun-filled process, right? And they made sure that it came into their science activities as well. They said that we don't want to be sitting in a place, right? We would like to move around. It's something that we enjoy doing, and you have a big campus here, and it's possible there are trees and plants, so let's do that. Yeah. Then they also made various artifacts, some of which you could associate with the science class, some of which you can't, right? So the artifacts included, of course, a scrapbook, which is more in the realm of science. But even there, you saw some interesting things, right? So the scrapbooks were titled, described, and styled in multiple ways, right? So one student described it as a wandering book, right? Decided to call her book a wandering book, where she wrote down, you know, her thoughts when she looked at the plants, right? Another titling it APU garden, right? And I never thought of it as a garden at all, but yeah, always thought PS was this bare place, but yeah, but there are so many trees, yeah. And use of popular cartoon characters to introduce content, right? Yeah, so you have the cartoon characters here, right? And they used, of course, the samples, what they had collected, and they styled it in their own ways, right? Each of them had their ways of organizing it, right, in particular ways, and talking about it, yeah? Yeah, then, of course, they made this children's magazine, right? and the children's magazine allowed them to bring in their interests related to art, right, into the science class. And they were very wary when they were talking about it. They were saying, I mean, it's supposed to be a science magazine. Can we bring in, artwork? Can we bring in vegetable prints? I said, yeah, why not? I mean, you can, let's see what is coming up here, right? Let's not keep it aside. So they brought in all of these. They brought in poems. Some of the poems were linked to the things they did. Some were completely unconnected, And artwork too was a whole range, right? Some of them involved plants. Some of them involved festivals, right? Like these pots and, decorated with vegetable prints. And so different kinds of artwork that came up, spray painting. And then they wrote up recipes, right, from their interviews with people, right? Ragi, for example, what are the dishes that are made here? Mustard, right? And they tried to write it up as a recipe and put that into the science magazine, right? Then also their worksheets. Some of their worksheets went in. So worksheets, it's not very clear, looked like this, right? Where there's a drawing of the growing plant. And this child has written, the ragi plant has grown very nicely and some leaves are small. And it took 3 days to sprout, right? So things like that as well. So different aspects which came into the science magazine. So those were some examples to see how they were trying to navigate, right, with this formal space that they had constructed for themselves regarding science, and merging and trying to navigate through these ways, right, moving around campus, because that's something they couldn't do in a typical science classroom, engaging with scrapbooks in a different manner, right, etc. Now the third is looking at a reshaping, right, of academic and everyday knowledge, which means how does the knowledge itself, right, get reshaped perhaps, or transformed. Of course, transformed not in the sense of a big transformation, right? We had a short space of a month to do all of this, so we're not looking at large transformations, but still, right, there could be competing knowledges and discourses which come into the science classroom, right? So for example, gardening, right? So gardening is something, again, that of course we may, as educationists associated with science, we've learned about Naitalim, and we've seen different examples of using productive work, etc., as part of the curriculum. But typically, no. I mean, it's something that's restricted to what you do at home, right? What you do as a hobby, right? Or what you do if your family and parents are interested in it, etc., right? So while thinking of appropriate, so this is something that they said they wanted to do, right? Gardening as an interesting activity. And while thinking of appropriate seeds to use for gardening, children brought in their carefully chosen seeds from their kitchen, right? So they asked their parents, what kinds of seeds can I possibly grow, right? So what kind of seeds from your own, thinking of your own kitchens, right, at home? Yeah? Grow fast? No, I don't think. That takes a bit of time, yeah? Tomato is relatively faster, yeah? Chili is okay, yeah, it again depends, yeah? Yeah, I've had all kinds of experiences with chili, yeah? Yeah, the sprouts, the mung, yeah, they grow faster. So for instance, ragi, which is there in everybody's kitchen, yeah, not in mine, yeah? But that's something that, so I didn't know, it grows so fast, right? It had, quickly this plant came up. And in fact, the seeds that they brought, all of them germinated pretty fast. So they bought these, dals, and which whereas I had brought carrot seeds, I'd seen them grow at home, but strangely, it didn't sprout quickly here, right? I know. But they did bring these seeds, and they'd ask their parents, what are the seeds that will grow quickly and surely, given that we have to finish the camp also, and we can make some observations, right? So they brought them from home. So they actually brought in all of these knowledges also into the space of a camp. And of course, the excitement of watching all this grow was coupled with this boring, monotonous science job of making observations every day, tabulating the observations, looking at patterns, right? How much time does it take to germinate? What are the differences between monocot seeds and the dicot seeds in the way it germinates, right? So connecting that, some of that was interesting, but some of them clearly said, I mean, it's tedious. Every day we have to keep looking at this plant, hoping that it'll sprout. Sometimes it doesn't. And then when it sprouts, you have to keep making these drawings, right? and then it doesn't grow much in the space of few days, right? But this was, yeah, the science bits of it, science conventions coming into what they found interesting, which was planting it, right, and seeing it sprout, right? So after that, it's not, takes more time, yeah? Then of course cooking was something that they again suggested, right? That we all make it at home. So they actually made it on the last day. We make it at home for dinner every day, and of course they were not excited about making this particular dish, but they saw this as relevant, right? And they saw it as relevant also because we didn't know much about it, facilitators. Right? Didn't know much about it as, okay, this is something you have every day for dinner. I mean, we don't see it around. If you go to a restaurant, it's not something that you get very easily, right? As much as your typical South Indian dishes that are found, right? So growing plants, ragi plants, and watching it grow was science enough. But then making ragi mudde on the last day was their way of also showing that, yeah, that we bring this as well, right? And we know how to make it. And we also saw, for instance, among the children, different discussions on slight differences. So as you pointed out, it's a very simple recipe, right? Involves boiling and making them into balls. But even within that, you see small local variations, right? So they brought that also in, right? Adding rice, for example, to the center, or adding a bit of salt. So small variations that one notices depending on which part or which community you belong to and things like that, yeah? And of course, they were very surprised that we had not eaten this dish. So bringing cooking, gardening, right, into, which may look like, you know, competing, right? Competing in the sense, competing for space with the formal science, right, into the science classroom. Therefore, transforming what one looks at as valuable, valid science knowledge. And of course, and we already saw interviewing, right? Interviewing members of their own and wider community, right? While children tabulated their observations of plants and insects and also looked at a few reference books to compile their scrapbooks, they were also excited to speak to their parents, to their friends, to their aunts and uncles who also invariably stay close by, but also part of the new place, right? That they were. So interacting with them, finding out different uses of, so these were the plants that they had grown, methi, mustard, carrot, ragi, bean, and coriander, right? And all of them, I think, did manage to sprout. Carrot took a bit of time, but yeah. Collecting insects, yeah. So this was another interesting observation that we saw among two children who were there in the camp, who were participants in the camp, right? Ramya and Shambhavi, these are not their real names. I've used two different names here, right? Shambhavi was, both of them were in the same class, right? 8th standard. And they were both interested in this topic and they were both in the same group, right? Shambhavi was very meticulous about her drawings, about her scrapbook, the way she had organized it and put it all together. Right, but she clearly said, insects is, we are in that group because, yeah, the group is about plants, trees, insects, but insects, collecting them or looking at them, yeah, not of interest, right? So she didn't put any of her collections into the scrapbook, right? Saying that she would prefer to just draw the insects by looking at a picture, right? And Ramya, on the other hand, who felt that she was being outdone by her friend, right? What does that mean? Outdone. So she felt that her friend was much better than her in general, right? Trying to answer all questions, taking initiative, seemed to be doing much better, right? But had one problem, didn't like to collect insects, right? But then she said, no, I'm very happy to collect insects, right? This is something that I enjoy doing, right? I like to follow them. In fact, she's the one who described following insects as, you know, following children, right? Trapping them through all these maze-like paths, making observations about them, right? And she also took a lot of care in her scrapbook to put all these insects together in little neat ziplocs, right? Plastic covers, right? And stick them in her scrapbook. And she took a lot of pride in doing that, right? More than the plants and flowers and all, which anyway everybody had collected. The insects was something that she focused on. She tried to make her drawings from the samples rather than making a copy of the drawing, right? So clearly Ramya was trying to bring up, you know, her own space there in the classroom, right? And she was negotiating a new role for herself to participate in the science class, right? And the new role there was as someone who loved insects, right? And as being clearly different from her friend, who was also very good, but was seemed to be doing better than her in the camp, right? At least in that was her perception. So clearly there she was making her presence felt, right? There was one other incident where Ramya had seemed to have an upper hand, right? So they were actually growing all of these seeds, as I said. And they were growing beans, carrot, methi, ragi, etc. So Shambhavi had all of these different experiences from her home environment, which she would bring into the science classroom. The fact that she just had a, you know, baby cousin who was born recently, and all of that, all those experiences. So because of that, she had all of these things to report about, you know, going to others' relatives' houses and for festivals. And there were so many festivals at that time, right? And Ramya, on the other hand, was carefully taking care of her plants, right? Because when they sprouted, they took them home. The children took them home, watered them, especially in the long weekends, etc., took care of them, right? So while Shambhavi had failed to take care of her germinating plant because she had so many other things to do in her community, right? Ramya was very proud of it, of the fact that she had lovingly nurtured her plant, and she grew this bean plant. So if you've seen the bean dicot germinating, right? It's a sort of dramatic germination, you know. Suddenly you see that the two lobes split and this plant, you know, just sort of emerges with a two, yeah.
I'm not getting one point here, that when we are talking about the plants, they grow, or when we are talking about the insects, means they are there in their environment also. So here, yeah. What kind of hybrid space
is
given to them?
Yeah. So here it is negotiating a new role for themselves in the classroom. It's a different kind of space, right, from what we had seen earlier. So the first we saw was a convergent space between what is academic and what is traditionally marginalized, right? The second we saw is a navigational space, right? Navigational meaning that they're trying, you know, making science artifacts, right? Doing things which help them succeed in a different kind of discourse community. Third is navigating a new role for yourself to make your identity, presence, right, in the science classroom visible and clear, right? So here for Ramya, it was this new role that she took up in the science classroom as being somebody who is attentive to insects and who's careful, taking care of her plants, unlike her friend. And this was, again, something that the children many of them decided in that group to take this up, which is, all of you have maintained a herbarium? Do you, all of you? I mean, those of you who have taken science would have, what does it mean, herbarium? Yeah, Ria, what does it mean?
Collecting leaves, different type of leaves.
Collecting leaves and?
Plants.
Okay. And what do you do with them?
Name, scientific name, origin.
Okay. So you try to classify them, and you may, if you are collecting it yourself, you'll dry it, right? So this is typically done in class 11 and 12, those of you who've taken biology, right? And suffered with it as well, yeah? Right? Yeah. Okay, so it depends. You know, some people enjoy it, some people hate it, right? That you have to collect all these specimens, dry it. There shouldn't be any moisture, right? Otherwise, it'll catch fungus. So all of this tedious thing of comes into biology, right? No, hardly any science there, it seems sometimes. But yeah, that's unfortunately the way it is constructed, right? And you have to stick them and label them appropriately, right? With appropriate classification, as she said, and you maintain that, and it's used for your practicals. Some component is used, right, as part of the assessment. Yeah. So a herbarium sample would necessarily be dried, right? And in that process, what happens to that sample? Yeah, those of you who have done it, or even otherwise. So when you dry the sample that you collect, what happens to that sample?
We finish them and we put some.
Yeah, but what happens to the sample? That's what you do with it, but what happens to that particular specimen? Yeah? So one, it loses color, right? So if you've got flowers particularly and you dry them, it doesn't look great at all. I mean, in the sense, of course, it's nice to stick because it becomes nice and flat, right? But loses its color and appearance is not that great. So this is something that they were introduced to during the camp, right? I was giving them newspapers and asking them to dry, right, their samples using the papers, newspapers. That's how typically it's done, right? You keep them in sheets of newspaper, change the position so that the moisture goes off, and over a period of time, you notice it becomes nice and dry, right? Ready to stick. So this is something that they found completely pointless, right? Something that takes away the nice white champa flower that they picked from, yeah, the ground and the nice bright leaves, all of them losing color, looking awful after a period, right? So while they did that, they satisfied me while they were asked to do. Towards the end, when they had to submit their scrapbooks, they quickly removed that, took fresh flowers and leaves from down, right, and stuck it. So this was something they found pointless, right? The idea of keeping the samples dried, right? When it loses color, when it loses appearance, right? So this was something that they brought in. I suddenly saw everyone doing this, you know, not paying any attention to what they had dried, right? An exercise to be done, and then collecting fresh samples to stick, right? So this was, so while they followed many other conventions, right? Like learning graphical representations, the smaller children in the group, those in the sixth standard were not familiar with making graphs, but they struggled with it, right? They struggled with it. They thought it was this nice graph paper, things to draw on it. They found it meaningful for some reason. They saw tabulation as being important, right? Another convention. But this was a convention they found completely pointless, right? And they discarded it without even asking me about it. Yeah. So disrupting the colors that they had observed, and they had also documented, right? The colors of that the flower had, and now the flower was completely different from their observations. Yeah. Okay. So any questions till this point before we move on to a discussion? Yeah.
So at the starting, you said that you found patterns,
yes,
different patterns. So were you talking about patterns among the students, like how they are learning, or did you find any kind of alternative conceptions while you were engaging with them or you were observing?
So the conceptions were there related to, what does it mean? You know, what does photosynthesis mean? We were discussing that, right? How does a plant germinate and grow, right? And where does the food get prepared, right, in a seedling? So we did notice, but the purpose, so my analysis here focuses on looking at certain instances which can be broadly categorized, right, as hybrid spaces from the literature, right? So when I talk of patterns, I was trying to see if the three broad categories of hybrid spaces that have emerged from previous literature, if I could look at instances, right? Two, three instances or different instances in my group of children, because they were just a group of five, right? And if I could sort of categorize them based on available literature. So I was talking of patterns in that sense, right? But there are some other patterns which I'll be discussing in the next section. Yeah, in the discussion we will look at patterns regarding informal spaces, patterns regarding what a hybrid space does for a child who is who may be looking at himself or herself as not fit for science in that sense. Yeah, so we'll come to that pattern in a bit. Yeah.
Ma'am, I'm still wondering or still confused about the hybrid spaces because the examples which you gave that about they were keen in knowing plants and catching insects and all. So these are the things which are like, do we really need hybrid spaces to create? Because it's all over, right? You don't need to go in any specific area to even create this. Plants are like tame, plug a plant.
Yeah, okay. But I don't think this is part of, so from what they have articulated clearly, they saw that the lab space and the informal space and the formal space, they saw as clearly different, right? Because they said that none of this comes into their school science learning about plants, right? Or when they learn about the dicot and monocot germination, they do not have these choices also available to them, right? Of bringing in their seeds from home, of being able to observe it over a period of time, right? So things like that. So while it may look like it is there around, it is not part of the formal science curriculum, right? And I'll also discuss some other elements which came through. Like, for example, we've already seen, right, use of outdoor space in a typical formal science curriculum, right? Outdoor space being used to move around. Being able to negotiate a new role for yourself, right, in the classroom. So these things can happen if there is space, but a typical routine doesn't perhaps allow for that space, right? So this is not the hybrid itself, this is part of the hybrid, right? The hybrid involves a merging of school knowledge and your sociocultural world, right? Of which the plants are part of. It could be part of festivals, it could be part of knowledge about that particular plant from one generation to the next. You understand? So it's hybrid in multiple ways, right?
So unless there's any instructor who could explain it about, like for example, taking the plants, what is that monocot, what is dicot,
yes.
So these are the things which can be happening in informal spaces and the learning can be given. But if it is just not an instructional type of, and it's just observing, then these observations can be made by the, I just feel so, can be made by the child itself.
It could be made by the child itself, but we had structured it. So there was facilitation from our side in looking at different developmental stages of the plants, for example, right? So looking at developmental stages in the leaves, in the flowers, in the fruits, right? Looking at different kinds of behavior within the insects itself, right? Then we also got into details of different orders of insects, right? So all of this requires facilitation, right? So not to do away with facilitation completely. That facilitation is required. So another point to consider here is we saw that science is, scientific concepts are special, are unique, in the sense that they are not just spontaneous, right? So if you look at children's conceptions, they do have various observations about the world. They do form their spontaneous theories, but they become scientific concepts only if we look at the formal scientific, the structure that is presented by a community of scientists as a concept in our textbook. So it doesn't become a concept till then, right? Or you may have your experience being very different, as we saw in the case of the flat earth or of the plant getting all its nutrition from the soil, right? Because a lot is provided in the soil, right? So it can be completely counterintuitive as well. So in this case, in the case of plants, it was perhaps easier in that sense, right? To connect to their everyday lives and bring in the scientific concept. In some other cases, it may be completely different. Your experience of the world may be completely different from the formal science that is presented in the classroom, which means then the teacher has to do a lot more work in bringing that in, right? But yeah, it is important to connect all of these observations into conventions such as scientific names, right? Classification, right? What is a system of classification? How did this evolve, right? What are conventions such as tabulation, graphical representations? How are they used in science, right? How do we understand germination, right? And difference. So there has to be scaffolding. It can't be without that. The role of the facilitator is important. Yeah.
Ma'am, in the beginning of the class, when we were talking about hybrid spaces, you said it's a combination of being academically the privileged and traditionally marginalized.
Yes.
Can you relate this example to this to throw more light on this? I got some connections, but not.
Yes. Yes. So ideally, traditionally marginalized would be looked at knowledge in communities, right, that don't find expression in the science classroom. Now, in this case, I would say that their informal experiences related to plants, right, so the honge or the gasagase, right, and how it is, so characteristics which are not learnt, but which are experienced, right, then use of different plants in the cultural environment, sociocultural environment, right, animals, in observations of animals in everyday life, right? Like the dead python there, or it could be birds, butterflies, right? So traditionally marginalized meaning the fact that these could be knowledges residing in communities, right? Such as medicinal uses of ragi, for example, right? Or it could be experiences which the child has, and therefore an intuitive sense of characteristics of that particular plant. or it could be related to their socio-cultural worlds, which involve these plants, right? And bringing that into the formal system of classification that we introduce, right? Parts of a plant, different kinds of plants, different developmental stages, right? So merging of the two, that's what I was referring to, yeah? Any other questions? Yeah, okay, so I'll quickly complete this discussion by, so there are different funds of knowledge that children brought in. Broadly, you can see that there are different funds of knowledge that that children brought in, right? School knowledge, as well as knowledge from informal learning, right? So school knowledge consists of certain normative expectations that they encountered in the science classroom. Knowledge linked to concepts in science, right? So there were certain concepts that they were very clear about, right? That they sort of understood as, certain broad understanding of classification, understanding of germination to some extent. Some of the older children had encountered different kinds of germination, but they were not clear about it, right? So there were some concepts that they were familiar with. They had some smattering of names of scientists on the top of their head, right? Who had discovered what systems of classification, etc., right? Knowledge of conventions, right? Some of them, older children were familiar with conventions used in making graphical representations and diagram drawing, right? They were also familiar with terms and facts from the school curriculum, right? And funds of knowledge also consisted of knowledge from informal learning, right? Informal learning meaning from television, films, and media, right? Visits to informal spaces such as planetariums. So some of them who were working on in another group on space research, right? They could bring in some of the informal experiences of going to a planetarium, right? And bringing that or trying to make a telescope at home with readily available, easily available materials, right? Discussions with parents, siblings, and relatives, right? That's also part of the informal learning space, right? Learning at home. And traditional knowledge, which we were just discussing about, right? Knowledge of local trees and animals from experience. Local cultural practices, right? Knowledge about food preparation practices, right? Which contribute to their understanding, right? So all of these, right? And then there's also certain perceptions about the nature of science, which came through, right? From these experiences, right? So nature of science as being, you know, textbook centered, a good science student as somebody who has these qualities or characteristics of being bright, of being conformist, of doing good, getting high marks, right? Getting good marks in the exams, right? Science as being something that involves doing experiments, but doing experiments doesn't typically happen in one's typical school environment, but it's very important. They all felt that it's important to do that because then you understand. Yeah, so things like that. So the different funds of knowledge which children brought in into this informal space, the informal space allowed for it, and hybrid spaces help one to merge all of these, right? To merge or to transform or to navigate these different funds of knowledge brought in from different sources. So they sensed that the school and the informal learning space was clearly different, right? But many of the children after the camp when we interviewed them, they said that, that science is hard though, right? Taking up a career in science is something that's much more than interest, right? That it involves sustained engagement, and we don't see too many role models in our community who have taken up careers in science as much as we've seen people take up careers in engineering or commerce, right? Things like that. So the children also clearly pointed out that we need longer periods of engagement to develop our own interests and to see ourselves as being, you know, engaging with science over a long period of time, right? So clearly this is a one-off kind of activity that we did, but this has to be sustained over a period of time for them to be able to get a sense of, yeah, that I have a positive identity, science identity, that I would like to take up science as a career, or at least see myself as being associated with science in the future. Yeah. And informal learning settings, we noticed that the informal context provides greater motivation, engagement, and interaction with peers. So we noticed that selection of content, right? Selection of content was based on interests. That there were multiple educational sites, not just the science classroom, right? All over the campus, their home, the community, right? And while it was also discomforting for both the, sometimes for the facilitators as well as for the children, in having that sense of uncertainty, right? for the facilitators in planning from one day to the next. For the children walking around in the sun, right? After a point, they said, it's very hot, April. It's quite, but it's okay. I mean, we're doing something that we'd like to do, right? And there was a sense of fluidity in terms of time, right? That comes into an informal setting, right? So there is, one isn't bound to a particular sense of time and a particular place or a fixed site of learning, so that's something that one notices in informal. So to conclude, hybrid spaces were negotiated by children to merge their social and cultural worlds with their science experiences and expectations. And while these spaces help them navigate their developing identities with normative expectations, they express the need for a continuity, right, in these experiences. And an informal learning space developed these exciting possibilities to bring in children's social and social-cultural worlds and merge them with the science worlds as presented in both the informal settings as well as what they brought with them from their formal science experiences and experiences in the family, community, etc. Yeah? Okay, so I think we've run out of time and we'll stop here. Yeah? Any questions to conclude? Yeah? Okay, so tomorrow you have your practicum, discussion with the teacher on the topic to be taken up, right? Some of you may have completed it. Those of you who haven't, please complete it. And next week, we will take up lesson planning, right? Development of a teaching plan, looking at different elements that come into planning for teaching, right? Considering your topic, right? And for that, we will draw upon children's conceptions as well, right? So we'll look at that. And you also have your assignment due regarding children's conceptions, yeah? To be submitted on Moodle, yeah? Okay, so we'll formally close this. Yeah.
Hello, and welcome. As you all know that this interaction is about your science education class this morning, I wanted to begin by asking, how did the class go for all of you? What did you think of the class?
I think the class went off very well, just like our usual classes, and it was very interactive, and the concept that ma'am had introduced today was very new, and I found it very interesting, and it made me curious in trying to find out that there's something called as science identity. And how children go about building this science identity, how they associate themselves with science. I think it was a very, very interesting topic for me personally. And as usual, you know, it's been very interactive, and where all of us ask questions randomly and she's able to answer them. And it brings about a lot of clarity to our own understanding also. And also we are doing chapters on misconceptions of children and what they bring into science or to any class when they come, what are their naive theories. And that's how I relate. You know, when we come here, we also have our own naive theories about what is being taught and our own notions of those topics. And they somehow get clarified when ma'am teaches. So I find that very,
as I feel that in the science class, every time whenever she's coming with the planning, complete structure, and I feel that the today's topic, it was more interesting for me because it was done by her own research. So I feel that this kind of research, if a teacher is coming with her own research, she's not teaching about the things which is done by others. So this is giving more inspiration to the students that they can also do something like that. Correct. So this was also inspiring for me.
Right.
The main thing for me was like the connections you built with your students and the the learnings which they have had in the previous classes. So the topics we started from misconceptions, alternative conceptions of children. Then we went on studying how the societal norms, and then we came to this topic. So we built connections with each previous classes we have done. So today also the same thing happened. We discussed what we have studied earlier, and then we went on, you know, discussing today's topic. Informal spaces and hybrid spaces were the new concepts for us. Right. We even hear about these words, but we never, you know, think. So, you know, we don't have concrete understanding of these words. Right. So, you know, having a proper plan and her her study, it really helped us to, you know, think properly about these two new words. And maybe in future, we could also think something else and something like this only to, you know, incorporate learning into children's through creating hybrid spaces or informal spaces for them.
Right. So for each of you, what would you say was your key learning from today's class? Would you be able to mention that?
So for me, it is very, being a teacher or being a student, so the main thing for me is like you need to be a reflective practitioner. So so today what I learned, so I have made herbariums in my 8th or 12th standards and I still keep them with me. I have it in my home. I was, regularly reflecting on whatever learnings I had in my science classes. And when we were talking about science identities, I was also thinking how my science teachers contributed in creating identities or, you know, confusing us, or I don't know why. Some people said science is not for us. And I was very much interested in science, but things happened that we did not had proper resources or experiences for us. That's why many children, you know, are not interested in science also. So I was regularly thinking why things happens like this. And I was, so my own examples, my friends' examples, and the practicum schools we see. So connecting these things with the kind of stuff she's taking in the class and we are connecting with it, I think that is more important for me. So, you know, reflection on yourself and on the things you are doing is very important.
Okay.
I think as she mentioned, as my friend mentioned, that it makes you reflect on your own ideas, your own notions of it. And here we are getting an opportunity to revisit science. And even I do not come from a science background, because primarily because it wasn't taught the way it has to be taught. But and to that extent, I also feel that there are a lot of children, even in today's India, that who fear science. So, which is why I have taken up science pedagogy, because I'm trying to see how best science can be taught to children in a more friendly manner, or in a more innovative manner, so that children don't fear it. And some of the skills I also pick up from our own lecturers when they I really admire their pedagogy, the way they teach concepts to us. The same thing probably I can also incorporate that in my future teachings.
So for me, it was looking like this. First thing, that science is just not about the phenomena which is there in the environment. That as she mentioned there, that hybrid space. So there she mentioned three things there. First thing, that class is not a proper space to do some science experiments. Right. So you should go somewhere. You are to navigate that kind of place where you can go and do some kind of science in that environment, which is required for the science itself. And the second thing, that how you can make yourself important to others. So she has given like two examples of two students, that one was just not liking that insects, but the other one who was that liking that insect, she collected the examples and she make herself own identity in the classroom. That way, that other girl may be having a lot other skills, but she does not like that worms, so she collected that insect and she made her own repo there in the classroom, that she also loved that kind of science environment around her. And the third thing, that the science itself is not about only the concepts, but you are to do something with that, and where the connection it is built there, that the context it is built with the formal education. So that kind of space is also given to them. So these things, these three things there.
Leading from there, do you value prior reading? Do you think that when instructors ask you to come prepared for a class. How important is that?
So for today's class, if we take example, I was reading the research last night and I read the whole research and I was so amazed to see that in that time we just came here, we were the new people here. So I didn't know that this kind of research was going on. I asked ma'am in the morning that it was it the time that when we people just landed here and the thing was going on, and she was smiling that yeah. So I was so happy reading the research, and then when she was teaching in the class, I could relate it to the PPT she was showing us, because of the time constraint, we were not able to go through the PPT properly. So I think it is very important so that you come prepared for the class, and if you will not, you will just, you know, be vague, you won't be able to understand much things.
Right.
So here they try to, you know, make things easy for us, but I think on the part of the student, it is very necessary that you read the readings, and because that will make much sense and you will be able to ask questions and you will be able to contribute to the learning of mm-hmm. other people also, our co-peers also. So I think that is very much important.
Okay. Would you like to add anything to it?
Yeah, I think prior reading is important, and at least glancing through the reading does help, because it helps us stay focused on mm-hmm. that particular topic. Mm-hmm. Then you don't really digress into different topics. And yeah, and once the class is done, going back home and then rereading also helps, because then again, if you have certain doubts, you can always go back to the teacher. Yeah, so I think prior reading does help.
And how valuable are classroom discussions that you have with your own peers in the classroom? What value do you see that as being an interesting and useful form of pedagogy for teaching, particularly, say, science education?
I think learning itself is an experiential exercise, isn't it? So each one of us come from varied backgrounds, mm-hmm. and each of us have different experiences. Even at that same age, we've undergone different experiences. So during our classroom discussions on one particular topic, we might have 10 different experiences, and they all come up during discussions. And this definitely helps at least me in knowing that, okay, that there are varied experiences, there are multiple dimensions to one aspect. Mm-hmm. And it is quite enriching for me. And discussions are therefore very important than everything being a lecture-based pedagogy,
right.
No?
Right.
And I think it also adds value even to the teacher.
Mm-hmm.
The teacher
Absolutely.
Herself has limited experiences.
Absolutely.
So when students, when all of us come up and discuss varied topics, it makes the teacher also think more critically, mm-hmm. more deeply on
right.
the subject.
So one last question, would you like to think of maybe borrowing from some other courses that you take? Is there anything that you would like to suggest that could be used in a science education class more effectively or differently? Any thoughts on that?
What I feel about this thing that basically it is completely based on the topic, what kind of topic
okay.
it is there.
Okay.
So if it is discussion based, then we are to go for the discussion. But when we talk about the lesson plan, then there will
yeah.
be some other pedagogy that student will get prepare
right.
that lesson plan, and
right.
they will conduct the classes here in the classroom first with the classmates, and then they can go in the classroom for the practicum.
Mm-hmm.
So where they are going in the schools and for the real experience of the teaching, before going there, they can conduct here the class with the classmates also.
I think for the science education, we already have a new concept of, you know, interviewing scientists and
okay.
Women
yeah.
scientists especially,
okay.
or someone coming from a socially backward class. And I think that is very new. At least I'm very new to this kind of an activity, and I'm actually looking forward to that activity because it's very different. I have not heard of it.
Okay, thank you all very much. It was wonderful interacting with you. I think it's always great to get a student's perspective about a course and a class. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.